Chapter 27, Absolute Reality. In one fluid motion, Cassie shoved her chair back, sprang her lanky frame to its full height, raised her arms above her shoulders, and shouted,
"This table is real!"
Before leaning forward and swinging her forearms down, bang! The table shook and everyone jumped in their seats. The outburst made Brad's stomach tighten and his jaw clench. What did I say to cause that? His medical training forced him to bend and look across the table, inspecting her arms for signs of injury. No evidence of broken bones, but damn, that must have hurt. Bruises should appear soon. He breathed deeply and his emotional reaction ebbed, compassion filling its place. "Are you okay?" he asked.
"I'm fine,"
she said, returning to her chair. Cassie looked around at the dozen startled faces. Her eyes were burning like fiery coals and a tight frown had formed on her face. Then she settled her gaze on Brad. He returned her stare with a sympathetic smile and looked around at the others. Several were frozen in their chairs. One man had jerked an arm up to block the attack. Now he lowered it. An older woman, who had until that moment been gifting everyone with a radiant smile, pushed her chair back, stood, turned, and marched out of the room. Shane, the facilitator of the San Francisco Self-Inquiry Group, inhaled deeply, cleared his throat, and said, Let's go to the next question. Papers rustled and bodies shifted in chairs. It was the worst outburst in the group's 6 months. Brad knew that because he hadn't missed a session. Good for Shane keeping his cool. Someone else might have asked her to get her temperamental self out of there, thought Brad. Before Cassie attacked the table, Shane had introduced the question. What is reality? It was one of Brad's favorite subjects, and he had been inspired to share. He enjoyed the spiritual community of the group, which had formed not long after his enlightenment experience. This table, he had said, slapping it gently with one hand, was not a table 100 years ago. It was a tree in a forest. 100 years from now, it will be sawdust or ashes from a fire or pieces of wood in a landfill. Everything has a beginning and an end. In the ultimate reality, objects or things are not real. Reality is that which has no beginning or end. This deepest reality is eternal, and everything else is an illusion. This table is an illusion. It is transient and not the ultimate or absolute reality. Brad had been pleased with his explanation and confident of its truth, but he had no hope of anticipating Cassie's reaction and no idea of what to do with it. As Shane opened the discussion for the next topic, Brad's mind spun. All of the great spiritual masters and teachers, from Buddha to the present day, said similar things about reality. I thought I could help someone understand. Why was she so angry? If she had simply disagreed with my share, she could have said so. Arousal of the primal fear was a fitting and sensible explanation for such a massive reaction. One that upset everybody and drove one of us out the door. He sat with his mind stirring, eyes on the table, watching Cassie in his peripheral vision. With her shaggy brown hair, baggy yellow sweater, and darting bright blue eyes, he would never imagine that she would tower up and frighten everyone and smash a pool table. Brad, how about sharing your views on compassion? Shane said, referring to his prepared list of questions. I'll pass for now, said Brad. He was committed to finishing his thought, and the discussion continued around the table. Aha! It came to him. Using the table to define reality triggered the primal fear of non-existence for Cassie. I can't blame her. Such a horrible thing to face. It made me feel sick for days. The teachers refer to it as the death of the old self, but it's worse than that. Just a hint of the primal fear would frighten someone who isn't ready. My heart hurts for her. He looked at Cassie with the very compassion they were discussing. She looked back and narrowed her eyes, and he returned his gaze to the table. There must be a better way to explain absolute reality. Brad, your turn, Shane said. What is your greatest desire? That one was easy because it had always been there, like a hard habit burning inside his soul. My greatest desires to help people, said Brad, adding, I'm also finding that it is one of the most difficult. The words made him swallow hard. No tears came, but his heart felt everyone's pain. I can say more, but I'm not sure if I should. Energy ran through his body and his heart felt as if it was expanded and connected with the entire cosmos. Thank you, Brad. Let's move on, said Shane, who cast a nervous glance at Cassie. The sharing of greatest desires went around the table until the group concluded and everyone strolled out of the basement room at the San Francisco Main Library. But a flame of inspiration burned inside of Brad to find a better way of explaining reality. In the evenings, Brad had been reading works by philosophers and spiritual masters after eating dinner quietly with Ellie and contemplating the nature of reality. She enjoyed hearing his ideas and knowing how much he wanted to be for the good of others. This mission to discover a new, better way of explaining reality, without using the table metaphor, was not like previous ones. It was a mission of its own accord, a creation from inspiration nurtured by his heart. If there was a drive to push him to find answers, it was out of compassion. It was a big project. He hoped to shed light on the dark night of the soul that had embraced the primal fear of non-existence, the fear that nothing was real, the fear that in reality, nothing exists. One night, while scanning pages of his notes summarizing definitions of reality, it came to him. Reality cannot be understood by a definition, or described as a specific state, or put in terms of a concept. Reality is a spectrum. Some things are more real than others. A spark or a puff of smoke is very temporary and not as real as a planet that is billions of years old. The ultimate, final, eternal, absolute reality is not a thing at all. Yet he had experienced it directly and continued to experience it. A sense of pure, undivided beingness that never changes and never ends. What is the key word? The words of the masters, philosophers, and others who had tried to define reality revolved in his mind, forming a language of abstract overlapping terms that he called enlightenees. The thought was intriguing. He imagined going to a group of spiritual teachers who were weighed down in a heavy discussion and saying, "Hello, I can speak enlightenees too." The thought rocked him back in his chair and made him laugh so hard, it wrenched his gut and brought tears to his eyes. Ellie appeared.
"I want to know the joke. Tell me."
He explained as she got it. He was fascinated by how she could understand spiritual teachings without any apparent learning process. Sometimes he felt as though he was catching up with her natural way of experiencing life and reality. But now she was just happy that he was enjoying himself and climbed into his lap to give him kisses. She giggled and retreated to some documents she was translating from English to Japanese, a part-time job that had come along. He returned to his thoughts. Out of all the words in the language of enlightenees, the important one was awareness. The word stood on its own, not that others hadn't recognized it. It was one of the most heavily used words in the area of psychospirituality. Perhaps some qualifiers could be applied to make for a better understanding of reality, one that wouldn't shock people with such primal, fearful response. Brad knew that for most people, something was only real if they could see it, touch it, or taste it. He called that perceptual awareness. But plants and animals have it too, so it doesn't make people unique from other species. What kind of awareness is that? Philosophers had centuries ago defined consciousness as the subjective realm of personal experience. We are self-reflective and self-aware, capable of recognizing that we have a consciousness, while other species don't appear to have the same understanding. Brad called this intellectual capacity human awareness. Those two terms captured reality that was common to everyday experience. Anybody could understand perceptual and human awareness. For most people, that was it. End of discussion. Yet the full spectrum of what humans are capable of experiencing goes far beyond that, beyond words. Yet there had to be words, something better than the fuzzy enlightenees that made people get glassy-eyed at satsangs, or the table metaphor that had caused Cassie to blow up out of the fear that a solid object wasn't real. Osho's story about feeling psychic pain, which he compared to a woman's labor, when he encountered the primal fear. Brad's inner torment and melancholy when he experienced the abyss of the primal fear of non-existence. The many stories of awakening he had heard at satsangs and read in books. He put it all together with aha moments and realizations from his spiritual journey and found it took the shape of a mind map. The map started with a root that had four trunks coming out, each part representing a level of awareness. The four trunks interconnected as well. The map represented one total possible human experience. The root represented the vast unknown that is only realized by penetrating the primal fear of non-existence. Once penetrated, it is no longer frightening and becomes known as a new and greater reality, the absolute reality. People could talk about unity even if they hadn't experienced it. Seeing the self and everything in the world as one continuous flow is well known and highly sought after by spiritual seekers. He called it unitive awareness. This made Brad recall a spiritual gathering where someone asked the teacher, "If you don't see things as separate, how do you walk across a room without banging your leg on a table?" A table again. The answer. The object arises in the mind as a thought and you reflexively react and step around it. Intuitive awareness is to experience the world as one continuous experience without the mind dominated by the separate objects. The next one came when he recalled his awakening after the India trip more than 15 years ago. It was a vivid experience of a present moment of infinite possibilities when anything could happen. Not a moment of time, but a moment of awareness in which past and future are memories or projections within a timeless present. He called that infinite awareness. He reviewed some sources he had read. Infinite awareness could correlate to the quantum field. It could be dark matter. No one could know exactly what it was because it was beyond scientific thought and understanding. But it could be experienced directly, and it was very real. The four trunks in his mind map to a better understanding of reality were named perceptual awareness, human awareness, unitive awareness, and infinite awareness. That left the root awareness of all of existence, the awareness that gave the direct experience of the absolute reality. Brad took a break and returned to the mundane life, living, loving, and working. The four awarenesses had crystallized in his mind and weren't going anywhere. At the end of the week, after getting caught up with work and errands, he returned to his studies. Sitting cross-legged on a rug, breathing deeply and slowly, meditatively, he was determined to find the word that would clarify the end of the spectrum of human awareness. One thought led to another, his consciousness streaming and calm energy coursing through his body. The deepest awareness was beyond describable experience. There were no thoughts, no sensations, no space or time. It was beyond having a silent mind, for there was no mind to be silent. Giving up all present moment experiences, as he'd long ago learned to do at will, he experienced a luminosity, a presence that had no attributes or conditions of any kind, a reflection of an experience. He knew that it could only be fully experienced after transcending the primal fear. They'd all taught it, calling it the final enlightenment, the realization of the absolute reality, the deepest spiritual awakening. How could he use a word to capture the experience more precisely? All knowing dissolves. The sense of I vanishes. There is no mental activity. There is clear awareness without a me, without an observer. Then it came to him. That was it. Observerless awareness. He went to the keyboard and summarized his new map of human awareness. Perceptual awareness, sensory experience, which is common to all living things. Human awareness, subjective realm of personal experience unique to humans. Unitive awareness, experiencing the self, world, and objects as one continuous flow. Experiencing the infinite possibilities of the present moment. Observerless awareness, direct experience of pure beingness without the observer self. Brad saved the file, stood up, stretched, and went to tell Ellie that he had precisely described the human experience of reality in a way that wouldn't cause an emotional breakdown.
I love the idea. You should tell everyone at the self-inquiry group.
He could tell that she was more captivated by the discovery because it made him glow with contentment and less interested in penetrating the primal fear of achieving observerless awareness. He hugged her in gratitude. She was perfect just as she was. Based on Ellie's suggestion, Brad began to prepare a handout to share what he'd come to call the five levels of human awareness with the self-inquiry group. Then a bigger venue called out to him and he dropped the idea of sharing at the library meeting. Would you like to go to Rome this summer?
Really? When? What will we do?
Her eyes were wide and shining. It had been a long time since they had taken a vacation and never one in Europe. An international group of scientists and spiritual teachers have formed an organization called Science and Non-Duality. They are holding open presentations for anyone who wants to attend the whole conference, he said. They're looking for the deepest truths about humanity and the universe. I can share the five levels of human awareness with the world.
Let's go. Give me the dates and I'll make reservations.
She got right on it, searching for air tickets to Rome. Brad went for his laptop and started the project, deciding it would be best done with visuals, settling on a poster presentation. Months later, they arrived in Rome and transferred their bags to a train heading north, where they would stay in an old castle that had been converted to a hotel with conference rooms. There were over 300 attendees, and nearly half were presenting. The syllabus listed over 100 abstracts of papers and posters on theories of consciousness and non-duality. Brad handed the registrar a long cardboard tube with a poster inside covering the five levels of human awareness. It was the product of 100 hours of painstaking work. They settled in and went around the lovely grounds, exploring the castle and enjoying 360-degree views of rolling green hills, reminiscent of Napa Valley wine estates. A lake sparkled in the setting sun, and birds called from trees adorning the grounds. They bunked in a two-level room fit for a nobleman and his lady, although hot water was in short supply. The next day, they attended talks together, choosing among three or four conducted simultaneously in various parts of the castle. Fred was scheduled to attend his poster before dinner that evening. Upon arrival, he found the five levels of human awareness poster pinned to a 30-foot-long, freestanding bulletin board. There were eight such rows filled with posters, so many that attendees could average no more than a minute or two on each without getting behind schedule. The crowd snaked through the rows, voices murmuring. Brad's poster had gorgeous visuals, a deep space photo of galaxies from the Hubble telescope, representing perceptual awareness. The Pioneer satellite's Greetings from Earth logo of a man and a woman, representing human awareness. A great sun that symbolized the primordial universe for unitive awareness, and a colorful quantum fractal for infinite awareness. As there was nothing that could represent observerless awareness well, he had settled on a mysterious-looking gray-blue orb whose gradient went off one edge of the poster. Paragraphs of descriptive text were printed below each image, and in a wide margin were tables comparing the phases of matter to phases of human consciousness. It had been carefully tested for readability, which took less than 3 minutes. Even before the 2 hours of the poster exhibit were up, everyone went to dinner. People were hungry, and it had been a long day. People admired the visuals, but no one stopped long enough to read any of the text on Brad's poster. One asked for his elevator speech. Brad was prepared for a select audience interested enough in the relationship between science and non-duality to travel to a castle in Italy, so he skipped perceptual awareness and human awareness, which were basic concepts. My image for intuitive awareness is a great sun that contains the entire universe before the big expansion. I like to think it could even define God. If our primordial universe, which we know is hot, dense, and smooth, also has awareness, love, and intelligence, that combination of attributes could give its expansion to become this highly ordered and evolving cosmos that we see now. And the man who had asked was not going to give a moment more.
Ugh, he said. You got me.
He squinted at Brad's name tag.
Who are you?
Brad. Okay, enjoy the conference. The man was not a mere attendee. He was a philosophy professor at an Ivy League university who doubled as a spiritual teacher and had published several books. The five levels of human awareness was not heading in the direction necessary to get recognized. The posters were supposed to be on display for 3 days, but at the end of the evening program came the announcement that they would be taken down early the next morning. A committee had decided that the room should be set up for a dance the next evening. After the first morning session, Brad arrived to get his poster, which had been rolled up and shoved into a trash can. It had cost $300 to have it printed on high-quality paper and was therefore worth salvaging and taking home. The Rosedales attended a few more lectures, then enjoyed the rest of their trip as ordinary tourists. It was delightful seeing the Colosseum and other sights in and around Rome. By the time the Rosedales were on the southbound train to Rome's International Airport, Brad had concluded that the world didn't care about the five levels of human awareness. It was a lesson in learning what not to do, but it had been fun trying. He went back to the doctor's work that was valued by society and paid the bills. He thought of how he might have reacted with anger or frustration at the failed poster presentation before he'd had his enlightenment experience. But if he hadn't penetrated the primal fear and opened to observerless awareness, there would have been no mind map of human awareness and therefore no poster. Everything interconnected. Writing a medical report was the same as finding a new way of describing reality. Being in the present moment. Chop wood and carry water.